من أص الله سبحانه وتعالى أذن ها فوت راو سلو ميسنا لنس فكما نن ها فوت راو تي أدبات وإنس إن شاء الله صديق بسيء وليتفضل مشكورا أخونا محمد أمي
الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله إمام المرسلين وسيدي سادات العرب والعجم عليه أفضل الصلاة وأزكى التسليم أما بعد أيها الذين آمنوا إذا قيل لكم تفسحوا في المجالس فسحوا يفسح الله لكم إن شاء الله تعالى إن شاء الله كم كلوز إن شاء الله تعالى سو ذاك كم لك يا رام إن شاء الله تعالى
سو سو خذ
إن شاء الله تعالى بس
سو
سامي إن شاء الله تعالى بارك الله فيكم first of all I want to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for giving us this opportunity. The second, I want to thank the organizers, brothers who are in charge of the masjid for their generosity towards us. Ask Allah jalla wa ala to put it in the midan of Hasanat. First of all, the lecture I had to give it in Somali. But inshallah ta'ala, even the youth and the youngsters and understand, and the other brothers who cannot speak Somali. So, inshallah ta'ala, we decided to change it to English. So, inshallah ta'ala, just want everyone to pardon me, inshallah ta'ala. If I try to mix English and Somali, then you have to catch me, inshallah. So that I stop. Inshallah ta'ala, the topic of today, which I want us to discuss, it is entitled Youngsters Who Believe in Allah. Fityatun amanu bi rabbihim. Brothers and sisters, we ask Allah Jalla wa'ala first to make this gathering a blessed gathering. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who will be, you know, the rahmah and the sakina, you know, tranquility and mercy will be revealed on them. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us that they are Malaika, the angels who go home and they look for gatherings. And then when they see one of the gatherings, they come and sit with us. So we believe that there are some angels who are sitting with us and praying for us. And you know, my dear brothers and sisters, there is a lot of people who are not here today. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen me and has chosen you to be here. So inshallah ta'ala, I want everyone to lend me his hearing. And especially the youngsters, everything that we'll talk about, I'll ask you something about it. So that I don't want anyone to be caught off guard. So try to, you know, give me your hearing, inshallah ta'ala, before. As we know, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if we read the Quran, I know a lot of us have read the Quran. In the Quran, there are a lot of stories. And one of the reasons why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala narrated stories to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, one of the reasons is Allah jalla wa ala says, وَكُلَّا نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكِ مِنْ أَنْبَاءِ الرُّسُلِ O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we tell you, we narrate to you the stories of the Prophet. Why? لِنُثَبِّتَ فُؤَادَ So that we may strengthen your iman. The story I want talk about today is about youngsters who lived at an age. That time that they were living, the majority were not Muslims. They were little youngsters. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala described them today as saying, Innahum fitya. Fitya, when it is translated from Arabic, is the youngsters or youth, boys and girls, who are between 14 to 19 years. So this youth, they were 14, between 14 and 19 years. I think a lot of us, maybe we're there or we're near there. Or we're there, we just passed with some years. So, أو بروف صلى الله عليه وسلم الله جل وعلا يرسل ناريت to hear the story of the people who and the prophets and the people. الله جل وعلا narrated the story of Nuh. Why? Because Nuh was a prophet. And he did da'wah to his people for 950 years and he just got a very small number of people who followed him. So every time when a prophet used to do da'wah and you know the people Allah جل وعلا said, وَإِنَّكَ لَيَذِيقُ صَدْرُكَ عَلَيْهِ مَا يَقُولُونَ. You know, they used to, you know, tease the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. They used to, you know, say bad things to him. But Allah جل وعلا narrated, you know, revealed the story of Nuh. Why? كَذَلِكَ لِيُثَبِّتِ الْفُؤَادَ. So that he will strengthen his heart, his iman. When he sees that no one is following him, he remembers the story of Nuh عليه الصلاة والسلام. So, the story which we want to talk about is about the youth of the cave, Ashabul Kahf. Ashabul Kahf. How did this story, you know, come? How was it revealed? How, you know, we have to know this Ashabul Nujum, this surah, which I think every one of us reads it every Friday. Prophet will speak about the, you know, the why Prophet ﷺ told us to read this surah. The version of the surah. The Prophet ﷺ says, "من حفظ عشر آيات من أول سورة الكهف عشرة من الدجال وصوابا memorized or memorized the first 10 ayahs of Surah al-Kahf عشرة من فتنة الدجال. He will be saved from the fitna of the Dajjal. We know the Dajjal. The Prophet ﷺ says that every prophet who used to come, they used to talk about the Dajjal. Every prophet until the Prophet ﷺ. He told us and taught us a dua. Who can tell me the dua when we read that shahud? The dua in which we seek Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep us safe from the fitna of the Dajjal. Who can tell me? Every when we see that Dajjal, barakallahu feekum. Every time we read for the shahud, we seek Allah جل وعلا's protection. We say Allah, Ya Allah, protect us from the fitna of the Dajjal. So, the Prophet ﷺ said, whosoever memorizes, look, the first 10 ayahs of Surah Al-Kahf, Allah جل وعلا will save him from the fitna of the Dajjal. This is the surah. And the Prophet ﷺ said, من قرأ سورة الكهف في يوم الجمعة أضاء له من النور ما بين الجمعتين. Whosoever reads Surah Al-Kahf, Allah Jalla wa'ala will make this surah to be a source of light. It will be a source of guidance. Why? Between the two Jum'ahs, Allah Jalla wa'ala will make it to be a source of light. We can ask ourselves, which type of virtue that is, you know, the surah has? Which type of, you know, because this surah is very heavy, you know. You just memorize 10 ayat, you are saved from the jannah. You read the surah, the whole surah, once a week on Jum'ah, Yawm al-Jum'ah, or the night of Yawm al-Jum'ah, Allah Jalla wa'ala makes it a source of light. Look, in this surah, Allah Jalla wa'ala narrates to us four stories. One, Qisas Ashab al-Kahf. The story of the youth of the cave. We will, inshallah ta'ala, talk much about it. And then, there is the qissa to Sahib al-Jannatayn. Sahib al-Jannatayn, the person who had two gardens. But what did he do? He denied Akhira. And then the qissa of Musa and Khidr. And then the qissa of Zilqarnayn. Look, the first qissa, when he brought this, it talks about fitna to deen. These youngsters, they had fitna in their deen. And we'll talk about it. They were youth living in a time of an age. The majority of people were not Muslims. They were not Muslims. So Allah Jalla wa'ala tried their religion. He looked at the iman. And then the second one is fitnatul mal. You know, the trial of wealth. This person, Allah Jalla wa'ala, he gave him land. He gave him gardens. But what did he do? He denied akhirah. What did he say? I don't think I will die. I don't think this land, you know, this house, this, you know, gardens and this rivers will perish. So what did he do? he denied Akh. And then the third story of قصه موسى موسى عليه الصلاه والسلام and خضري the pious seven was about فتنة العلم. موسى عليه الصلاه والسلام he thought that he is the most knowledgeable. So Allah جل وعلا wanted to teach him that وفوق كل ذي علم عليم. That upon and if you see someone who is knowledgeable, there is someone who is knowledgeable than him. So Allah جل وعلا this is فتنة العلم. Many brothers and sisters, all of us, we are between these fitness. If you're a youngster, you're trying on your leader. If you're someone with the wealth, you're trying with the wealth. Will you be the zakat? Will you, give the masakin their haq? You know, will you use your wealth in the right path? And fitna to ilm. When someone becomes knowledgeable, maybe you're a doctor. If someone is an engineer, you've learned the religion of Allah Jalla wa Ala. Will you use this religion in the right way? Or will you make the source of looking down upon the people? Maybe you are not knowledgeable, and then you see someone who is an illiterate, analphabetic, can't even write. Instead of teaching, what if you just stand and start teaching and say, look at this person, he's a foolish. It's a trial. So it's the trials whereby the human person passes every day in his late life. So my dear brothers and sisters, we'll talk about Surah Al-Kahf. How did Surah Al-Kahf, how was it revealed? This surah was revealed in Mecca. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, him and his sahaba were in a trial. They were very weak. It was the time when Bilal bin Rabah was being punished. It was the time the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam passed in front of Ala Yasa. What did he say? Isbiru Ala Yasa, fa inna mawidakum min Jannah. He came by and then he saw the family of Yasa being punished. He could never do anything. But he said, oh Ala Yasa, have beautiful patience. Indeed, if you have this patience, then you are born, the place which what you will get will be Jannah. Just have patience. It was a time when Prophet was in a very big problem. So, despite all these problems, what did the Quraysh do? We know the Quraysh used to disturb Prophet. So they were every time, every now and then, they just tried, they gave him names. They say he's a sahir, he's a magician, Majnun, he's a mad person, he's someone who's looking for fame, So what did they do? To say that there's some people, two people. One is another Ibn Harith. I want you guys to track how to just take his name. Because inshallah ta'ala I'll ask you. The first person was another Ibn Harith, and Uqba ibn Amr. Another Ibn Harith and Uqba ibn Amr. They say, we've heard this Jewish scholar who's living in Medina. We'll go to him and ask him some questions. Some little bit of questions, and then we'll come back. So they went to Medina to ask him. And they wanted some questions whereby they could ask the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then if the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam could not answer them, what would they say? Look at him, he doesn't know anything. So when they went to this Jewish scholar, they said, there's someone who is claiming to be a prophet. We want you to give us some tangible questions whereby if you ask him and he doesn't answer, then we can start teasing him and abusing him. Okay, he said, ask him about, ask him three questions. If he gives you an answer to the questions, then he's a true prophet. First, ask him what happened to the young youth who lived at an age of time and then disappeared. They lived. Ask him about youth who disappeared. They just disappeared. That's the first question. The second question, ask him about the mighty traveler who reached east and west. He traveled from east to west. And the third question, ask him about the Ruh, the spirit. So then they came back to Mecca. They came to Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Nadr al-Harith and Uqba ibn Amr. They said, O Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We have three questions. They asked him, tell us that the youth who lived in age or time but disappeared. And tell us about this person who traveled from east and west, and tell us about the ruh. Prophet, you know, he became happy. He thought that if he answered these questions, then they will believe. So he told them, come tomorrow and I'll give you the answer. But he forgot one thing. What did he forget? Who can tell me? The Prophet, he told them to come tomorrow, the next day, but he forgot to say inshallah. So when the next day came, Jibril came to him, but he came with another revelation. He never answered the question. The next day, the people came. Nadhr ibn al-Harith and Uqba ibn Amr. They said, okay, ya Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, tell us the answer. He said, I've not been, you know, look, he said, I've not had anything. Just wait. Those people who claim that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was talking from his own, you know, things. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam couldn't say anything, isn't it? Allah Jalla wa'ala says, وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he doesn't talk from his, you know, from what he says is true and true revelation from Allah Jalla wa'ala. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, I'll answer you. What did they do? They waited for the next day. They came, given the answer, no answer. The third day, fourth day. These two people, Quraysh, they said, Alhamdulillah. Now we can go around and say that this person is a liar. Because if he has true revelation from Allah Jalla wa'ala and he gets revelation as he claims, then he has to have the answers. My dear brothers and sisters, they started going around in Makkah and saying that, oh he's a liar, he doesn't know the answers. After 15 days, this, you know, it became very heavy on the Prophet, Allah Jalla wa'ala revealed the answer. Allah Jalla wa'ala says, نحن نقص عليك نبأهم بالحق. But the first one, you know, this story became very heavy on the Prophet. So the Prophet, you know, just wanted to know the answer. So Allah Jalla wa'ala says, أم حسبت أن أصحاب الكهف والرقيم كانوا من آياتنا عجبا. The Prophet told me, oh Muhammad, do you think the story of أصحاب الكهف, you know, and Raqim is the wood with their names were written on them. Do you think their story is one of the biggest wonders, you know, or one of the biggest creation? Do you think that the story is one of the biggest wonder? Because he thought that the story, because people he wanted to know the answer. But Allah Jalla is telling him, خلق السماوات والأرض is greater. The creation of the heaven and the earth is greater than their story. Okay, the story is a good story, very good story, but the creation of the earth and the heavens is greater than the story. So my dear brothers and sisters, why do you want to talk about this youth? I think that we, like as Muslims and youth who are living at this time, we are Muslims living in a majority whereby we are the minority. And the majority don't have the same faith as us. So we are like in a ship. We are like in a ship, just flowing. If you do something with a mistake, you just go in the water. Because the water is the disbelief and everything. And then we as Muslims are just in the ship. So this youth were in the same problem. But my dear brothers and sisters, they managed to go against the order. And we know that, my dear brothers and sisters, Allah Jalla wa'ala, when He said, نحن نقص عليك نبأهم بالحق, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who will narrate to you about their story. إنهم فتنة. Indeed, they were youth. Allah Jalla wa'ala, He specified the age. He said that they were youth. Youth? Why? My dear brothers and sisters, you know that the Prophet told us that the seven people or the seven groups who will be or will be under the shade of Allah Jalla wa'ala يوم القيامة اليوم at that day that there will be no shade except the shade of Allah Jalla wa'ala. The second, first one, Imam Al-Adil, a just leader. Two, tell me, وشاب نشأ في عبادة الله, a young star who is steadfast. He has lived the life of a young or the youth life steadfast, holding upon his religion. We know that يوم القيامة the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم told us that the son of Adam will not put his feet down except after he has answered four questions. And one of them is Allah جل وعلا will ask him an عمره فيما أفناه. He'll ask him and he'll ask every one of us about our youth. What have we done with it? Look. And عمره فيما أبلغ. First question is, only your lifespan. Allah جل وعلا giving you 50 years, 60 years. What have you done with it? And then Allah جل وعلا will specify the question. You'll have to have an answer. When you were youth, when you were young, what did you do? Did you believe in Allah جل وعلا? Or did you finish your day playing games, not playing salah, going to clubs, not following your mother, you know, abusing the people, you know, using hash, you know, going astray? Will you say that? Or you will answer by saying, oh Allah, I was a steadfast youth. I was a steadfast youngster. I used to believe in you despite everything. I know, my dear brothers, I'm young. And we all young. The majority are always, you know, trying to push us into the haram, isn't it? The majority are trying to take us in their way. Shaitan wants us to follow his way. You go to school, there are some girls. You go to university, girls. You know, maybe you're not married. You have fitna. Allah Jalla wa'ala tells us to lower our gaze. A beautiful girl passes in front of you. Will you lower your gaze? How will you look at her? You come somewhere, someone tells you, oh, brother, let us do some good business. You get good money. Sell this hash and everything. If you say mashallah, oh, you'll get, you know, 20,000 krona, alhamdulillah, yeah, with one day, do the business you've done. My dear brothers, if you get this money, it becomes haram. Eating it is haram. The clothes you're wearing is haram. Yawm al-qiyamah, when you die, Allah Jalla wa'ala will ask. Living in the same place, you will not, maybe you will live your whole life in a gangster life, and then what will be the result? You will be gunned down, isn't it? Because all the gangs, you know, after some time, they start fighting with each other, shooting each other, and then they die. We still look like after that. How many people do you know that, who are, you know, youngsters, you knew them, but now they are shot, they are killed? How many? How many do you know that are you know, behind the bars? How many do you know that they are just, you know, drop-up? They cannot go to school. They cannot do anything. They have no life. Why? Because they went astray. Medieval and Christian, wallahi, I'm telling you, being steadfast while you are youth, that is the best thing you can do. Allah praying you fast five times. You know, trying to lower your gaze. You know, Allah Jalla wa Ala will put barak in your life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make everything easy for you. Even the study will be easy. The fitna which maybe you're living in, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make it, he will give you some, you know, strength to go against them. So the reason why I told this story, and the reason why I had to change the language so that we understand, is that dear brother sister, Allah Jalla wa Ala, he narrates this story so that we may take heed, so that we may take lessons, dear brother sister. Allah Jalla wa Ala says, now he tells us about the story. O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أَمْ حَسِبْتَ
أَنَّ أَصْحَابَ الْكَهْفِ وَالرَّقِيمِ كَانُوا مِنْ آيَاتِنَا عَجَبًا.
Do you think, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that the people of the Kahf and Raqim, Raqim have thought that they did the wool, the piece of tree which they wrote their name on it. Do you think it's one of the wonders of our signs? Allah Jalla wa'ala started narrating this story.
إذ أوى الفتية إلى الكهف فقالوا ربنا آتنا من لدنك رحمة وهيئ لنا من أمرنا رشدا.
What did they with this? What? There was a king. This king was not a just leader. The people disbelieved in Allah Jalla Ala. So what did they do? The king, as the historians narrate, his name was Qityanos. I need to get this name. Yeah, I'll ask about it. But I'll ask it inshallah ta'ala at the end of the session. The name was Qityanos. Qityanos. This king was not a just leader. They didn't disbelieve in Allah Jalla Ala. So these youngsters, what did they do? They saw that these people are disbelieving in Allah. They say that we have to seek refuge in where? In the cave. When they went to the cave, what did they say? Rabbana, our Lord, atina, bestow on us rahma, mercy. Wahayyi lana min amrina rashada. And facilitate and make our affairs easy. Wallahi, they were in the state which most of us are. They knew nothing. Oh Allah, have you seen that maybe you are, you come inside somewhere, and then there is a lot of haram in that place, yeah? In the classroom, where you work. There is a lot of fitna. So, you don't know how to get out of the fitna. So this youth, they were in a fitna of disbelief. The people are disbelief, but they want to escape, but they don't know. So when they say, وَهَيِّ لَنَا مِنْ أَمْرِنَا رَشَدَ They say, oh Allah, facilitate our affairs and make it easy for us. Because they don't know nothing. The one who Allah Jalla wa'ala guides is the guide one. And the one who Allah Jalla wa'ala has misguided, no longer guiding, isn't it? How many people do we know? Who wallahi, they are the most, you know, the subhanAllah, the best people. But Allah Jalla wa'ala has not given them the hidayah, the guidance. Best people, better than us. But Allah Jalla wa'ala has not written for them. And hidayah, guidance. So, what did Allah Jalla wa'ala say?
فَضَرَبَنَا عَلَىٰ آذَانِهِمْ فِي الْكَهْفِ سِنِينَ عَدَدًا.
This youth, when they seek refuge, when they ran with their religion to the caves, Allah Jalla wa'ala says that we made them sleep for years. Now Allah Jalla wa'ala starts narrating part of this story. Allah Ta'ala says,
ثم بعثناهم لنعلم أن الحسبين أحصى لما لبثوا أمدا.
When they were raised up, people started, you know, quarreling, asking, you know, how many years have they been living? Have they slept? So Allah Ta'ala said, O Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, because the Quraysh asked you about the question and the story, I will narrate it to you. Allah Ta'ala said,
نحن نقص عليك نبأهم بالحق.
We narrate unto you their story with truth. You know, my dear sisters, this story, as the Jew scholar knew, the Christians knew about the story. If you go back in the history, you can read about the story. So our Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Allah is telling him, we narrate to you the truth of the story. Okay.
إنهم فتية آمنوا بربهم وزدناهم هدى.
They were youth. آمنوا بربهم. Who believed in their Lord. When they believed in Allah Jalla wa'ala, Allah Jalla wa'ala, what did he do? Increased them. وزدناهم هدى. Allah Jalla wa'ala increased them in guidance. First of all, they believed. One of the scholars, Salih, he passed by someone who was just, you know, sitting somewhere. This person was passing, he was a scholar. And then he saw this guy, you know, sitting there, he said, Oh Allah, Allahumma inni as'aluka khairul ilm, Allahumma inni as'aluka khairul ilm. He's just sitting somewhere on the road. Oh Allah, I ask you for the khairul ilm. The scholar, you know, said, Oh, tell me, what are you saying? He said, Oh Allah, I'm asking Allah Jalla wa'ala to give me khairul ilm. The scholar said, My dear brother, you are asking for something which is very big. But what are you doing? Instead of, you know, sitting here, you could be just in the sujood and asking. So you're asking something which is very big, and what you're giving out is nothing. Look, these youngsters, they took the first step. إِنَّهُمْ فِتْيَةٌ آمَنُوا بِرَبِّهِمْ. They took the first step. They believed in Allah Jalla wa'ala. And then Allah gave them guidance. If you want something, you have to start. In everything.
it's one of the the normal life. You want something, you have to offer. You want to have a very good future, you have to go to school. You have to learn. You have to work. You have to get money at the end of the month, you have to work, isn't it? Same way. This youth, they believe in Allah Jalla wa'ala. You want to succeed in this life and the hereafter. What do you do? Will you just, sleep? Maybe better. You wake up in the morning, despite you wanting to sleep. Why do you wake up in the morning and pray? Because you want Jannah, isn't it? You want the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You want to, to give the rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, isn't it? So Allah Jalla tells us, he's teaching us something, that these youth, they took the first step, they believed in Allah Jalla wa'ala, Allah Jalla wa'ala said, was it in our food, and we increased for them, then. What did Allah Jalla wa'ala say? Allah Jalla said,
وربطنا على قلوبهم إذ قاموا فقالوا
We made their heart firm. Allah Ta'ala said, when they believed in us, we made their heart firm. That is what we want. Once you believe, Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala will make your iman firm.
إذ قاموا فقالوا رب السماوات والأرض لن ندعو من دونه إلها.
The first step was, what did they say? Our Lord, Rabbuna Rabbus Samawati wal Ard. Our Lord is the Lord of the heaven and earth.
لَن نَدْعُوَ مِن دُونِهِ إِلَهًا.
We will not call upon any God. We shall never call upon any God other than Allah Jalla wa'ala. First of all, they were in shirk. So they took the iman. They said, we will not believe what these people are believing. These people have denied Allah Jalla wa'ala. So they say,
لَقَدْ قُلْنَا إِذًا شَطَطَ.
They say, indeed, before them, proclaiming and saying that we believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Maria, brothers and sisters, they ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive them. Indeed, oh Allah, before we were people who were misguided, but now we have seen the light.
Allah Jalla said, what did they say? هَؤُلَاءِ قَوْمٌ اتَّخَذُوا مِن دُونِهِ آلِهَةً.
These people have taken for worship gods other than him. Look, the Prophet ﷺ, they asked Mu'adh, oh Mu'adh, which is the greatest dhulm? The greatest mischief that a son of Adam can do. Mu'adh ibn Jabal said, Allah Shura. Prophet Allah and his Prophet know the answer. But the Prophet said, أَن تَجْعَلَ لِلَّهِ نِدًّا وَهُوَ خَلَقًا. You know, to try to disbelieve in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after Allah Jalla wa'ala has created him. Our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that the father of Imran bin Hussein, his father, Imran bin Hussein was a great Sahaba. His father was not a Muslim. One day, the father of Imran bin Hussein, he came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Look, I want to teach you one tactic, you know, how to do da'wah to the non-Muslims. When this person came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he misbelieved. He never believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet also asked him, how many gods do you have? He said, seven. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, try it, you know, I want to understand how many. He said, six gods are living, you know, with me, are in the earth. And one is in the heaven. Okay. The Prophet said, okay, how many? Seven. Six in the earth and one in the heaven. Okay. The Prophet said, I'll ask you a question. If a trouble or you enter a trouble, maybe there's no rain, which of the gods do you call upon and you pray to? He said, Lord, the Lord of the heaven, the one in the heaven. He said, do you ask the six gods? He said, no, I don't ask them. Okay. When you get, sick, whom do you call upon and ask and pray to? Rabbus Sama.
He said, I call upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you want wealth, who do you call upon? He said, I call upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, look, when you have problem, you call the Lord of the heavens, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you are sick, you call Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When you want wealth, you call upon Allah jalla wa ala, the Lord of the heavens. But look, which great mischief are you doing? That the one whom you're calling in every trouble, when he gives you wealth, you use this wealth to disbelieve in him. You are disbelieving Allah jalla wa ala. You believe, when you have a problem, you call upon Allah. But when Allah jalla wa ala takes this problem from you, what do? You call other gods, you know. You try praying, you know, to these other gods. The Prophet was trying, you know, to make it, you know, the shahada, the believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a very, you know, easy way. Because I'm telling you, just ask the Swedish, the Danish. When you have a problem, what do they say? When something happens, oh my God! Isn't it? They know there is a God. Oh God, help us. Have you been in an airplane, then, you know, the airplane starts, you know, shaking. What do they say? Oh my God, oh my God, oh my God, oh God, help us, isn't it? If they are maybe they believe in the Buddhist, you know, who worship the idols, do they run to the idol and say, oh, idol, help us? No. Allah, all of them, they look at that, to the heavens. They know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is there. But whosoever Allah jalla wa ala guides, he's the one with them. So these youngsters, what did they do? They said that we will not disbelieve in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What did these youngsters do? They had nothing. They wanted to seek refuge. They wanted to flee and run with their religion. They said that, وَإِذْ اِعْتَذَلْتُمْ وَمَا يَعْبُدُونَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. These youngsters thought about Allah Jalla wa Ali in a very good way. They had something which is called husnul dhann. What did they say? They said to each other, when you withdraw from these people, فَأُوُوا إِلَى الْكَهْفِ. Run to the caves. يَنْشُرُ لَكُمْ رَبُّكُمْ مِنْ رَحْمَتِهِ. If you run to the cave, they're telling each other, you know? If you run to the cave, Allah Jalla wa'ala, what will he do? He'll open a way for you. يَنْشُرُ لَكُمْ رَبُّكُمْ مِنْ رَحْمَتِهِ وَيُهَيِّئْ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَمْرِكُمْ مِرْفَقًا. He will open ways for you, and he'll make the way easy. And it will make all your affairs to be easy. That's why a Muslim, the Prophet ﷺ taught us to have what is something which is called husnul dhann, to think good of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Allah Jalla wa'ala said, أَنَا عِنْدَ ظَنِّي عَبْدِي. Allah Jalla said that I am with the intentions of my dhanni of my servant. If you think good of Allah Jalla wa'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you the goodness. If you think bad about Allah Jalla wa Ala, then you will not get accept what you want. This youngster, my dear brother, they had nothing. They had no one to help them. They were living in an age of time whereby the majority were against them. But what did they do? They thought good about Allah. They believed that if we flee with our religion, if we live here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will open doors for us. Look, I'll put it in a scenario whereby most of us will understand. Maybe you're working, isn't it? You have gone to school, studied, finished, and then you get your first work, your first job. But the work is maybe working at a store. You know most of the stores. Maybe if you sit at the cashier, you'll sell everything, isn't it? You'll sell the pork, you'll sell the alcohol, you'll sell the bread and milk, isn't it? You've been struggling for all your life. Maybe you've been, sending hundreds, sending your CVs everywhere. And then this shop comes up and says, oh, we want you to come and work for us. Isn't it? Look, maybe you're believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will puts you in a trial. You want this job. Maybe you need this money. Working the store is something maybe okay, you're looking upon to get money, everything. But working this type of thought is not good. Earning there is haram, you know, because selling Prophet ﷺ cast. Anyone who sells what? Alcohol, isn't it? And pork and everything. So, if you stay steadfast, and deny this job without, you know, without having anything else, maybe you don't have anything. If you deny this job, maybe not, you say, you know, you don't have any something to change. If you believe in Allah Jalla wa Ala and leave it for the sake of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you have to believe that Allah Jalla wa Ala will change and give you something better than it. This is what the youngsters did. They believe that if they flee with their religion to the caves, you know, if I tell you just enter the bush, you know, run into the bush and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will help you. I think I'm the first one to say, subhanAllah, how can I just seek this with us, isn't it? But this youngster, they had iman with you. That is the iman we have to have. We have to be strong. We're living in a very, you know, subhanAllah, a hard time. Whereby Prophet told us, يأتي على الناس تماما القابض فيه على دينه كالقابض على الجمر. There will come a time whereby the one who's holding to his religion will be like a person who's holding a coal of charcoal. Can anyone hold a coal of charcoal? No. Can you? If I just put a charcoal in your hand, can you? What will you do? You know, you start trying to throw it. That is how we act. Because everything is against you. Look, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this is a bishara to all of us, a glad tidings. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sitting in the Sahaba, he said, oh my Sahaba, there will come a time. People, there will come a time. Those people who will be living in that time, one prayer which they will pray, they will get ajr and the thawab of your 50 prayers which you pray. The Sahabas were like, what? 50 prayers of us will be one, you know, will be equivalent to one salah of theirs? The Prophet said yes. Look, one salah which you pray, you get 50. It's like 50 Sahabas or a Sahaba who was praying 50 times. This hadith is the Sahih. The Prophet gave them the reason. He said, إِنَّكُمْ تَجِدُونَ لِلْخَيْرِ أَعْوَانَ وَلَا يَجِدُونَ لِلْخَيْرِ أَعْوَانَ. Indeed, all of you're getting, you have someone who is helping you. I'm the Prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'm with you. If something bad happens to you, if any one of you goes astray, then I'm here to, you know, help, isn't it? But those people, they will not have anyone to help you. Sometimes you're somewhere, you look in the bus, you're the only Muslim, isn't it? You enter a building, you say, this way, right, up, down, there is no Muslim, isn't it? You have no one to help you, Allah, you have no one to help you. If you want to pray, you are the only one, you know? Maybe the place you are working, you are the only Muslim. Where you go to school, you are the only Muslim. I know that. We are living in that time. The Prophet said, one prayer which we will pray, is you will get the ajr of 50 prayers. Imagine. So, these youngsters, when they entered the cave, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Allah ta'ala narrates to us. What did he do? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They entered the cave. When they entered the cave, you know that if you sleep, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made them sleep when they entered the cave. As a human being, when you sleep on one side for the whole night, what happens in the morning when you wake up? You'll have some pain, isn't it? Or you have some marks, you know, on your body. What about someone or people who have been sleeping for 300 years? SubhanAllah, all their bones will be gone, isn't it? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and when they were in the cave, you know, at night, there's no sun. In the morning, the sun comes out. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, His mercy upon this youth and youngster, because they believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they ran with their religion. Allah jalla wa ala, when He ordered them to sleep, even in their sleep, Allah jalla wa ala was guiding them. Or was guiding them. Imagine. Even in their sleep, Allah was guiding them. When they slept on one side, Allah jalla wa ala turned them on the sleep. When it was on the morning, Allah Jalla wa Ala turned them. You know, when the sun comes, you know, if you have a direct contact with the sun, what happens? Will you get burned? Allah Jalla wa Ala used to turn them so that the sun doesn't burn them. and at night he thanked them. And then Allah Jalla Jalla said that when you entered and came to them, what happened? You could run. The scholars say that when they slept, Allah Jalla Jalla, even the eyes. If you close your eyes for 1 hour, or 2 hours, or a whole day, you think you will open it? Can't open it. But Allah Jalla Jalla, He made them, look, even Allah, their eyes, Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala put them on control. Allah Jalla Jalla made them to asleep, sleep, but their eyes, when you enter the cave, you will see that they are awake. لَوَلَّيْتَ مِنْهُمْ فِرَارًا Look, وَلَمُلِئْتَ مِنْهُمْ رُعْبًا But the next thing is, Allah Jalla Jalla says that he could stop here. لَوَلَّيْتَ مِنْهُمْ فِرَارًا When you, Allah Jalla Jalla says that, when you could come to the cave, you could just run from them. Because you know, so if you know, what do you imagine? I'm sleeping, and then I'm like this. And then what will you think? My eyes open. Will you just think that I'm dead, isn't it? So the Prophet Allah Jalla Jalla said, when you enter the cave, you could think these people, you know, they had a face whereby made someone run. But Allah Jalla said, وَلَا مُلِئْتَ مِنْهُمْ رُعْبًا Not just fear, but you could, you know, be shocked. And the Prophet, the Mufassirun, they say that this type of shock is a shock whereby you cannot speak about. Have you ever been in a problem whereby when someone asks you, please can you talk about it? Whereby if you enter an accident and then the police and the traffic come and ask you, how did the accident happen? What did you say? Isn't it? You can't even talk. Allah Jalla Jalla tells that if someone could see them, could be in that state. You could even say it. That is one of the protection. Because Allah Jalla Jalla didn't want the people of the town to know that these youngsters are in this cave. Even in their sleep, the Mufassirun, they say that this youth live, Allah Jalla Jalla guiding them outside their sleep. Even in their sleep, Allah Jalla Jalla guided them. And that is how every one of us will be guided with Allah Jalla Jalla and by Allah Jalla Jalla if we follow His way. And dear brothers, if you follow the way of Allah Jalla Jalla, Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala will guide you in every way. Anything you want, Allah will give you. But you have to do one thing. You have to believe in Allah. You have to follow His way. You have to take the Sunnah of Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Then Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala will guide you everywhere. Even in the most darkness of the time, Allah will guide you. Even while you're in a very big problem, Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala will guide you. You just have faith in Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. Think good of Allah Jalla wa Ala like this youth who thought good of Allah and Allah Jalla wa Ala guided them. So, one thing the Mufassirun. There's one thing they thought, and I want to speak about it inshallah ta'ala very short. And I think subhanAllah bomb due to time. They say that look, Allah Jalla wa Ala, He even narrated to us the story of their dog. Look, Allah Jalla wa Ala says when they came outside, among the people of the town, you know. They started asking about, how many are they? People started asking about it. Allah Jalla wa Azeem, سَيَقُولُونَ ثَلَاثَةٌ رَابِعُهُمْ كَلْبُهُمْ The first time the dog is, the name of the dog is narrated in the Quran. سَيَقُولُونَ ثَلَاثَةٌ رَابِعُهُمْ كَلْبُهُمْ وَيَقُولُونَ خَمْسَةٌ سَادِسُهُمْ كَلْبُهُمْ رَجْمًا بِالْغَيْبِ This is the second time. وَيَقُولُونَ سَبْعَةٌ وَثَامِنُهُمْ كَلْبُهُمْ How many times is the dog narrating? سَيَقُولُونَ ثَلَاثَةٌ رَابِعُهُمْ كَلْبُهُمْ وَيَقُولُونَ خَمْسَةٌ سَادِسُهُمْ كَلْبُهُمْ How many kelb is it? It's about three, isn't it? Three times. Allah Jalla wa Ala even, narrated, the company, their company. Who was in their company? So that the Ibn Kathir, Allah Ali said that because this dog was in the Suhbatul Aqiyar, in the surrounding of good people, Allah Jalla wa Ala narrated to us, the dog. Imagine. It means that if you are with the good people, What will happen to you? Will be no. I will tell you who you are. If I tell you who is my friend, you will know who I am. Because your friend is like a mirror, is a reflection of who you are. Because you have the same character, that's why you became friend, isn't it? If someone who somehow we don't rhyme with each other, you cannot speak, can you be friend with them? No. So they say that Qur'an says that everyone of you is in the religion of who? Of your friend. فَلْيَنْظُرْ أَحَدُكُمْ مَنْ يُخَالِدْ. So every one of you, let him take heed and look whom he makes friend. That is why you see a very good brother, mashallah, he prays in the mosque, stays fast, goes to school, maybe works. Mashallah, very good boy. But subhanallah, he makes bad friends. In 2 months, 3 months, he's not in the mosque. You start, meeting him on the road. Ya akhi, why don't you come to the mosque? Inshallah, will come. He's the boy, he's the young brother who used to be in the first line. Maybe he used to make a run. But after he made bad friends, some friends who never used to pray, what did they do to him? They made him like them. Allah Akbar, Allah Akbar, he listens to the adhan. Maybe he comes, the reminder comes, oh, it's salah. The friend said, no, inshallah, you'll pray after 1 hour. Yes, I want to pray. No, inshallah, no problem, no problem. You'll make, they make fatwa to him, they give him some fatwa. No, inshallah, no problem. Do what I'm asking, you can pray them together. No problem. It's called tadirij. Shaitan, when he wants to, take you out of the way, he never takes you at one go. Like knockout, no. Shaitan never works like that. The ulama, when they say it's called sequential persuasion. This guy, Shaitan, he pursues you. When he makes something haram, first of all, you do something which is haram. Maybe at the first time, it's very hard to do. You know that this thing is haram. If I do it, subhanAllah, astaghfirullah. So the good person, when he does something haram, he says, astaghfirullah. That's the first thing. The next time he does the same haram thing, what does he do? Oh, inshallah, alhamdulillah. I'm just doing one haram. I know people who are doing 10 of them. Alhamdulillah. I'm just doing one. 1 month, 2nd month, 6 months, 1 year, you're gone. You come to realize whereby, at a time whereby, subhanAllah, everything is finished. You're gone. So, that's why Allah Jalla wa Ala said, when He was prohibiting al-khamr, He told us not khamr, al-zina. What did Allah Jalla wa Ala say? La taqrabu al-zina. Don't come near it. Look, Allah Jalla wa Ala never told us not to do it. No, don't come near it. What leads you to zina? What is the first thing which leads you to zina? Having a haram relationship. You have a girlfriend. Mashallah. Can we meet at Starbucks? Can we meet at McDonald's? Can go out? Mashallah, there's no problem. Inshallah, there's no problem with Allah. We'll go together, we'll go out. No, we want to marry each other. This is the shaitan. We'll marry each other, no problem, We have to talk to each other. And then you start going, places which wherever you are alone. Alhamdulillah. And then, the shaitan, this is the shaitan. Whispers to you. We have to have a good, we have to take pictures together. First of all, he takes the picture. Inshallah, I'll take a picture. The next time, come here. Can we take a selfie? I want to show you my family, how we look. This is the second time the shaitan is, trying to persuade him, And then the third day, subhanAllah. This picture is not, you have seen the pictures in the internet, you have to hold each other. What does the sisters think? Oh, this guy is the one who will marry. They don't have. What will be the fourth thing? No problem, inshallah. Meet somewhere else and then that's why the Sha'ari thing, when he was talking about how people get to know each other, he said first of all is nadra. Maybe you're meeting you're walking in the town and nadra. You see, maybe you meet a girl. First of all is like the eyes, Mashallah, that young guy, mashallah. There is the first contact, eye contact. And then comes maybe after 1 month, and then you meet again on the road. What happens? You smile because this is the second time you meet him. The third time, maybe after 2 months, we meet somewhere in our relative's house, you know, somewhere.
I got out.
Oh, my sister, bye. You good, huh? Hey, how are you doing? My name is Hamdah. My name is Rahim. Okay. Can we exchange some numbers? This is the shaitan. You know, he's trying to pursue you. And then the next one is, oh, mashallah, raikum. Ah, that brother, you know, mashallah, I saw you in the mosque, mashallah. Can we miss? This is the sequential. This is how shaitan pursues you. And then at the last time, he went, what happened? He went to the haram. So Allah Jalla wa'ala tells you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows you. He knows you. He knows the shaitan. He tells you, close all the doors. You want to get married? Wallah, I will tell you, I will give you. Ali, subhanAllah. I'm married now for almost 4 or 5 years. Wallahi, let me tell you about it. I think maybe, who are the youngsters? How many are not married? Raise your hand if you're not married. How many? You're married. You're many. I'll tell you something. I think you have not, you know this thing. You talk to your girl, you talk. When everything is near, subhanAllah, even if you are friends on Facebook, you block each other. Why? What happens? What happens? You talk for some time, but nothing is going on. Well, I've seen brothers, even mass in our time. SubhanAllah. You talk with a sister, you talk. Maybe you go to learn about the sister? Through unlawful ways, you know. At school, maybe you got the number from someone else. Friend on Facebook trying to chat with you, the whole night you're talking. You know, you start speaking on the phone, the whole night, oh. You start calling, at the first one your brother, sister, the next day you, my lover, oh. When everything is near, shaitan comes and makes whispers to you. Ask her something. SubhanAllah, something happens, everything goes, nothing in works. And then you learn another guy. Talk. So, SubhanAllah, I remember me and some other friends were there. SubhanAllah, everyone has a whole book of history. 5, 6, 7, 8 sisters. One day now we sat together and asked ourselves, Ikhwani, what is the problem? Wallahi, we came to understand that the problem is that every time we try to know our sister, we use the wrong way. Allah Jalla said, Wadkhulul buyuta min abwabi. Enter the houses on their doors. You want to know a sister? Wallahi, I'm telling you, if you see a sister, maybe a good sister, instead of going to her and approaching her and smiling with her, look about who's the brother and sister. The cousin, okay, maybe you fear to go to the father, or the Asha, they're known that. Just catch a low, you know, father and I love your daughter, can you? What are you saying, you know? So, okay, because it's somehow unofficial, what do you do? Look for the brother or the sister, a cousin, someone who knows the sister, you know? Try to look for these people and then try to make the connection. Wallahi, this person, Ajib. This person, what will happen? The sister, even Wallahi, the sister will believe in you. Will say, Wallahi, this guy, he has a bit of respect. So I'm telling you, to make the story short, you want to know a sister? Use the right way. Which is the right way? Go to the brothers, even you. But if someone in their family knows about you, she'll have some bit of respect. Do you want to meet her? Go to the house. Because there's one thing, Ajib, if you just want to get just a girl and a girl from where we will be talking and we are chatting with her all the day, yahi, imagine you come to your house and then a guy is speaking with this. Will you be angry? You'll be angry, isn't it? Know that this sister whom you're just chatting with her whole night and all day has a brother. And their brother and the sister and the father, no one don't want the sister or the children to just speak to every guy. So use the right way. All life, you use the right way, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make everything easy for you. So let me make the story short of these youngsters. These youngsters,
when they wake up, when they woke up after 300 years, what did they were hungry. They said that, okay, let us go out there and look for food. But they thought, oh, subhanAllah, we cannot go, all of us. Let us send one of us. They sent one of them. And then, what happened when they sent one of them? When one of the youngsters, when he went to town, they had some money. And this money, when they wanted to buy, when they gave the money to the people realized them. They said, this, where did you get this money? They said, oh, it's a normal money. SubhanAllah, they said, this money was used, the last time this money was used was 300 years ago. So they catched them. So the youth, they never knew who was ruling there at that time. They just thought that through the Qiyanus, the unjust leader. So they were caught, they were took to the leader, but subhanAllah, the leader was a pious person. So what happened? The guy, you know, caught them. He asked the boy, tell me about this story. He said that we are the youth who flee, because of their religion, to the cave. SubhanAllah. Because these people, they knew about their story. So what did they do? The king and the people saying that, take us to who? To your other fellow brothers who were in the cave. They went to the cave. So the one who was sent outside, what did he do? He said, wait for a minute, these people, they never knew, they don't know if you are coming. Let me enter and tell them. And SubhanAllah, when they entered, when he, that was this person, this youngster entered the cave, what happened? Allah Jalla wa'ala took their life. They died. No one. When these people came inside, they found all the youngsters died. So Allah Jalla wa'ala, we don't know the exact number. We don't know the exact number, but the lesson which we are learning is, dear brothers, inshallah ta'ala, we'll finish with this one, is that wallahi, our salvation is in the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we believe in Allah jalla wa'ala, follow the ways of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, follow, you know, the rules of Allah jalla wa'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will open ways for us in everything. Inshallah ta'ala, ask Allah jalla wa'ala to make us steadfast. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those ones who will follow the footsteps of these youngsters. Ask Allah jalla wa'ala an yaj'alana, ya nas'al Allah jalla wa'ala an yaj'alana kha'ula'i al-fityati alladhina amanu. We ask Allah jalla wa'ala to make us like these youngsters who believe in them. Jazakumullah khairan jaza. I thank all of you for coming and barakallahu fikum wa salaam alaykum wa rahmatullah.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا وحبيبنا محمد بن عبد الله صلوات الله وسلامه عليه. And inshallah, we thank Allah for the Iman, we already fought out and min almost about in Qarib, in the Kaldir. And they don't make a tech. No man can disappear out, no man can sing out, it's true, it's still alright, the way it is shall show. So in order to continue our, it's still not alright, the way it is shall show. Where do we go, where do we get at it? Okay, inshallah, Yehovah, and they have a known to go boot, you know. So inshallah, the Imam Dora Seya, or Yehovah, we say it again, some to respond, some still, there's a lot, right? Problem 6. Barakallahu feekum. Maftanallahu alayhi. Wa assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salam ala rasulillah. Khayari Abu Abu Hassan, jitka ma'naha ihtiram kama'rata, inshallah, la ilaha illa Allah.